epitome of that, who cuts across all of that. So we are really delighted to have her be our guest speaker tonight. And please help me welcome Her Excellency Virginia Palmer.
Thank you, Joe. You may have talked longer than I'm going to. Seriously, Joe was my first phone call here, and I have very much trust his counsel, as I know Aisha has said she does too. AmCham President Aisha Badawi Iwe, friends and distinguished guests, all protocols observed. Please forgive me if I get a little corny, because I love Thanksgiving. And I think the AmCham Thanksgiving is a particularly important one because it gives us a chance to celebrate AmCham's achievements and to pause and give thanks for the U.S.-Ghana relationship and for what you have achieved in what has been a very difficult year. And if you will allow me, because the AmCham here is actually very Ghanaian flavored, I will give you the shortest version of the Thanksgiving legend that I subject everyone who comes to my Thanksgiving table to. But the Thanksgiving feast in America is really a harvest festival, but the first pilgrims that came to the United States, or I'm from Virginia, we claim that it was settlers in Virginia, came to the New World fleeing religious persecution in the United Kingdom mostly, and suffered incredibly, almost starved to death. And many, many of them died of disease and hunger. And they were assisted by the Native Americans, who came and taught them new farming techniques and protected them. And then when they survived a horrible winter and made it through to their first big harvest, they invited the Native Americans to come for a big feast. And that's the sort of beginning of Thanksgiving. And we have commemorated that ever since. We gloss over when we tell the story some of the terrible injustice that later followed with the Native Americans in kind of typically American style. But I still think it's a beautiful holiday to celebrate diversity and togetherness and gratitude and to stop for a minute and be thankful. And around within my family and around my Thanksgiving table, in 11 countries so far, and that's one of the blessings that I count, we make everybody go from the youngest to the oldest and say what they're thankful for. And I'm always struck at those international tables by what we have in common, what we are similarly thankful for. But I'm going to jump the queue a little bit because I think I may be the oldest person here and say a little bit about what I'm thankful for. And then I'll talk just a little bit about what I think AmCham has achieved and what we need to look for going forward. I think first of everybody's list of what to be thankful for is the health and well-being of our families. And I know those of us who are far from home feel that particularly on holidays like Thanksgiving. And I have a new grandbaby. So I was saying it's proof that I love Ghana, that I have come back to Ghana. And then every year I also say how thankful I am for the prosperity and freedom that we often take for granted in the United States, but which is really part of our American identity. And that's been challenged more in recent years than I like to admit, but it makes me aware of how precious it is and how grateful we must be for it as we fight to protect it. And I'm also thankful for the tremendous work that AmCham has done and for our partnership with you. Your support for Ghana's private sector-led recovery, as well as your concrete advice to both the United States and the Ghanaian governments, is more essential now than ever before to improving the business environment. And we should all give thanks for the service of the outgoing chamber executives. Please let me salute President Aisha Badawi Iwe, Vice President Paco Shum, and other board members who've been terrific partners. Let's do another round of applause. And I too will tell one little Aisha story. I invited the ambassadors and other chamber heads to my house for lunch because I thought, gee, Ghana's in a no-kidding economic crisis. We have common cause. And it was kind of war talk around the table, you know, like, this is terrible. We need to do these things. But there wasn't any action. And Aisha then whipped everybody into shape and said, we need to have a letter. We need to have a letter in 2 weeks, and we'll do this. And the result, I think, was engagement from the Minister of Finance and others in the government of Ghana. So I think that was really her leadership in action. I like to see that, yeah. I will also note for the record that she's given me a to-do list every time I've seen her. So, and congratulations to incoming President Kamathi Kunyeya. We're looking forward to working with you too, Kamathi. One of the highlights of this year was our cooperation with the AmCham on the U.S.-Ghana Business Forum that Aisha's already mentioned. Thanks for your tremendous efforts for that event. It was attended by more than 800 people, and it projected the full spectrum of U.S.-Ghana economic and commercial engagement. A new budget enterprise franchise was launched, and several new MOUs were signed as a result. And it signaled that the United States remains Ghana's steadfast and best partner. And if steps are taken to improve the business environment, American business is extremely interested in trade and investment with Ghana. One of the key issues at the forum was the role of the African diaspora and how better to leverage that force. Every day I'm reminded how critical the diaspora is to our partnership with Ghana. I'm conscious that I'm an old white lady talking about this. But the diaspora, you know, was born or built on the tragic history of the Atlantic slave trade. But then it has developed into something much more vibrant and much more important to both countries. It began with students studying in the United States from Ghana, including Kwame Nkrumah, who came back to lead Ghana to independence. And then that independence was so important, not only to other African nations, but to African Americans at home who were struggling for justice. And so I take very seriously that Black Star Rising. And that too, and what it stands for, needs to be protected. That tradition, if you will, of studying in the United States has continued to expand. We just had a report on Monday that was released that Ghana is now the 14th largest sender of students to the United States in the world. Yeah, that really is quite something, considering Ghana's relative size and also the visa backlogs, let's be honest. We're working on that. But I think that will continue to define the diaspora for generations to come. The head of Brookings Africa Growth Initiative, Dr. Landry Signe, calls the African diaspora a mega trend that will positively impact Africa, and I would argue will particularly impact Ghana. We know it well here in the business community. Mona Boyd, Joe Mensah, and others, you're leading this charge and really are poster children for what the diaspora can mean for both countries. Vice President Harris's historic visit highlighted the role of the diaspora in the creative industry and other industries in Ghana. And back at home, the White House created the President's Advisory Council on African Diaspora Engagement to recommend to President Biden how we can further leverage the diaspora's strong interest in Africa's development, prosperity, and security. The Council's 12 members, sworn in by Vice President Harris just last month, are representatives of the African-American and African immigrant communities in the United States. They're distinguished individuals from government, sports, the creative industries, business, academia, and faith-based organizations. One of them, the director of the Smithsonian's National Museum of African-American History, Kevin Young, was here with Vice President Harris, and I think, I have not cleared this with the embassy team, but I think we should see if we can get the council to come to Ghana. Ghana absolutely has the African diaspora community's attention. As our Global Diversity Trade Mission to Ghana in August showed, the African diaspora is ready to do business in Ghana. However, macroeconomic stability and trade and investment policies matter to that diaspora just as they do to business people all over the world. Diaspora investors know if others are not getting paid. They know if there's a lack of contract sanctity or if there's an overly aggressive tax collection. I'm being diplomatic. Treating existing investors, you here in this room, well, tangibly improves the investment climate. And unnecessary barriers to entry and partnership, such as high minimum thresholds for investment, hinder it. We have terrific small and medium-sized enterprises on both sides of the Atlantic that could be partnering on creating new ventures. For Ghanaian companies facing really sky-high interest rates, an investment infusion of even $50,000 could be transformational. And why inhibit that? But when we talk about lowering barriers to trade and investment, we also need to talk about treating people fairly and ensuring your employees are safe and protected from legalized discrimination. So I want to broach a subject which I know is a little bit sensitive. But it has a more important business context than most people realize. Ghana's parliament is considering a bill that would curtail the human rights of the LGBT community, their families, allies, and quite frankly, all Ghanaians. Everybody has opinions about the issue, and I respect those opinions very much, even if I disagree with them. But very few people have read the bill. I think very few people understand that the reality is that the bill undermines the basic free speech rights that Ghanaians otherwise enjoy. The goal of the bill, the drafters are not shy about advertising, is to make Ghana hostile, not only to LGBT people, but to anyone who even sympathizes with them. It seeks to make illegal all discussion and all media that even mentions LGBT issues. So journalists would be arrested, landlords would be arrested, mothers and fathers could be arrested. If passed, the bill will make it harder for you not only to recruit and hire the best people from overseas, but it will marginalize educated and hardworking Ghanaians by making it clear that they are unwelcome. I have no doubt that such legislation would have a chilling effect on Ghana as an investment destination. Companies have already talked to me about American consumers being unwilling to buy things that are made in a country with such repressive legislation. It'll make it harder for me to sell Ghana as an investment and trade destination. So the legislation, in addition to undermining public health and public order, would reduce forex inflows, cut into your bottom line, and reduce your workforce options, not something Ghana's suffering business environment needs now. I'm truly thankful for those of you who've had the courage to raise these issues with Ghanaian policymakers. As representatives of the business community and as the partners Ghana needs to be a truly inclusive 21st century economy, your voices need to be heard now more than ever. So to sum up, implementing simple pro-business policies could accelerate the diaspora megatrend that we are all seeing and some of you are embodying. But Ghana won't benefit automatically from that trend. Foreign companies moving here to invest and employ Ghanaians need to see trade, regulation, and legal frameworks that allow businesses to thrive while protecting their employees. I remain optimistic that Ghana's tolerance and democracy will prevail and that her stability will continue to thrive, and Black Star Rising will continue to be a beacon for the rest of West Africa and beyond. And I trust that with your help, challenges in the business environment will be overcome. And you can count on my help and the help of the team at the embassy to magnify your voices, to have quiet words in the ear of the president or the ministers, or to speak out publicly when required. And I'm confident that the U.S. partnership with Ghana will go from strength to strength. So, let's give thanks for the many blessings in our lives, both big and small, and remember that the heart of this holiday is the spirit of forgiveness and togetherness. And I'm very thankful for all of you. Happy Thanksgiving.